Welcome to Make Me Over, and I'm your host for today, Michelle Dawsbert. Thank you so much for joining us today. I'm super excited because our topic is all about our mental wellness and health and well-being. My organization is all about Real Chicks Rock, and it's all about the empowerment of women. And we care about your health, your wellness. We do things in our communities. We want to stay active. And we have a podcast and a radio and television talk show. And so today is no different because we're going to invite the conversation about mental health and wellness. And my guest today is Narissa Gilliard. Hi, Narissa, how are you?
Hi, I'm very well. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. Thanks for joining us. So give us a little bit of background about yourself.
So my name is Narissa Gilliard. I am a licensed therapist in the state of Michigan. Mm-hmm. And I also own a nonprofit organization called Black Girls Crowned. Mm-hmm. And we are really striving towards destigmatizing mental health within the Black community. And we do this through several avenues, like Michelle was saying as well, through mentorship of our young ladies. I also provide, I have a private practice in which I counsel those who are interested in individual therapy, group sessions, especially geared towards Black women and the Black family and that experience. And then also we have a podcast and radio show that is called The Melanated View with Narissa.
Awesome, awesome. Tell me the name of your organization. How did you come up with that? That's really cool.
So it's called Black Girls Crowned because I believe that my ancestors are kings and queens. My ancestors were brought to America, tortured, enslaved, and it's almost like their crown was taken away from them. And I believe that we need to get back to that royal mentality. And what better way to do that by starting with our mind? We have to begin with our mindset and really tackle the trauma that not only we're experiencing right now, but the trauma that our ancestors endured that's still being passed down to us today.
Awesome, awesome, awesome. Narissa, tell me, what inspired you to become a professional licensed counselor?
Well, I would say that I believe that this is really my purpose from God. Mm-hmm. And I've known that I wanted to be a therapist since I was a very young girl. And really it began just by seeing other people hurting and seeing that we don't really have an avenue in which that we feel comfortable talking about the things that we are going through. Right. And so I was very involved in church, and my mom and my dad are also both very spiritual and involved in church. And just by seeing them as an example of being able to give back to the community. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to give back to my community, and my community is the Black community, and I'm very, very passionate about us just coming back together and really having that traditional culture and that village.
Mm-hmm. Awesome, awesome. I want to talk to you about our current state, right? We're currently going through a pandemic, mm-hmm. and it's been about 6 months now. So in your opinion, do you find that our mental state has been improving prior to the pandemic, or how are we looking now with our mental health?
I don't believe that our mental state was improving prior to the pandemic, and then the pandemic came and it made things a lot worse. People are obviously isolated, not by choice, but then we also think about those who were already suffering with depression and anxiety, and how much worse that has really made them, and also addiction as well. A lot of people are turning to drugs and alcohol and other risky behaviors because we just don't know how to cope with it. We don't know how to deal with the fact that I can't go see my mom and dad. I can't even, you know, you can't go to the hospital. We couldn't go to the nursing home. And even to this point where now, you know, we're able to see each other a little bit more, we still can't embrace each other like we used to. We can't hug, we can't show affection in that way. And that's something that human beings really need. And we are just suffering so much. I am seeing so many more people than I was prior to this pandemic.
Really?
Yes, because people are realizing that they are feeling very depressed. Mm-hmm. Every day we're waking up and it's like we don't really have that hope for the future anymore, right, because we don't know what it's going to look like. Mm-hmm. Let's just say, you know, post-pandemic, are we still gonna have to wear masks? Am I really gonna, be able to have encounters with people like we did before? Right. Are kids even gonna be able to go back to school? Mm-hmm. So it's really like a major stressor that is coming out, and to the point where I know even for me, I've struggled with, do I even want to get up today? Because it's for what? You know, we're still working, but we're working from home. And so, of course, that allows for us to be a little bit more lazy, right, of course. Right. But it's like we just don't have that hope for the future anymore. Mm-hmm. And that's why I'm very grateful that so many people are reaching out for support. But then I also think about those that don't feel comfortable reaching out to a therapist or to anyone out of that pride and out of, you know, the fear of being shamed for that.
Oftentimes, it's very difficult for us as African Americans, mm-hmm, because when we feel a certain way, our community, our village, or people around us tend to make us say, you'll be fine. Girl, you'll be okay. Mm-hmm. You know, have a drink or sit down or, you know, do something, but you're not crazy. Mm-hmm. You're gonna be fine. Mm-hmm. So the fact that more of us are starting to realize that we need to speak to someone, mm-hmm, about our mental state, the way that we're feeling. The fact that you're depressed, I think that's okay, but I think that you're not supposed to be in that space for a long length of time.
Right.
So much so that you don't want to get up in the morning. Mm-hmm. That's where that's an issue. And I want to talk to you a little bit about some of the triggers that people see or experience in dealing with their mental health. Can you name some, share with us some of the triggers that people would endure?
Sure, of course, one of the biggest triggers, especially right now, is isolation. Mm. Like I was, just saying, we're not able to meet with each other in the way that we're used to, and we need that. Also, I'm seeing a lot of people that are very paranoid now, especially in regards to medical paranoia, where especially we're coming up on flu season again. Yeah. I don't know if I have the flu, if I have allergies, or if I have COVID.
Right.
And that alone is enough in itself. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So it's making people very paranoid to even go to the store. That was one of the biggest things that I had to address with a lot of my clients at the beginning, was this fear of, okay, I need to go to the store because I need to eat, but I'm afraid that I'm going to, get COVID,
right,
or anything. And so a lot of people still have that stuck in their mindset, and, we're practicing social distancing. So it's just really making us very paranoid, mm-hmm, and like hyper aware of our surroundings. Mm-hmm. And some people feel like they're just kind of walking zombies, right, at some point. Right. I definitely noticed that at the beginning of COVID, of where people just seemed like they were just so lost.
Yeah.
And who can blame them? Because this is something completely different, mm-hmm, and something that we don't know how to cope with because we've never experienced this before. Mm-hmm. So definitely that isolation, and then being very paranoid, which causes anxiety, which causing us to have those racing thoughts, which causes us to sometimes go into that deep depression, and it causes some people to have suicidal thoughts.
Yeah. The conspiracy theories are real, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. I think a little bit of sci-fi, a lot of people watched movies and feel like this is a replication of what they've watched before or seen. Mm-hmm. And so it's a lot of things that are going on. There is a paranoia where there are still people that have not gone out. Mm-hmm. They've not gone to the supermarket. Everything is bought online, Insta this, Instacarting, Amazoning, everything that they can do online, they're doing that. And it's a whole procedure. If someone comes to see them, it's a whole take your clothes off, serious thing. And it's really gonna be a unique opportunity for us to try to adjust when this pandemic is lifted off of us. Mm-hmm. One of the things I wanted to ask you, Narissa, is how can we tell? Like, I think I appreciate the triggers, that's great, but how can we tell when someone's health is really deteriorating? Can we really tell when that's happening?
It depends.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, especially in the Black community, we are so good at hiding how we feel. Mm-hmm. We are so good at hiding the fact that I am depressed.
Yes.
I might be suicidal and still getting up to go to work every single day. It's very difficult for us to really see the signs and symptoms. But there are some ways that you can tell. One, if someone's behaviors start to change, let's say they're usually super talkative and they're always reaching out to you, they always want to go somewhere, and now they're not answering phone calls, they're not on social media as much as they used to, and when you do talk to them, they just sound very down and depressed and a lot of times very negative. Mm-hmm. Or you hear them talk about like their anxious thoughts, so they're, you know, obsessing over different things. Mm-hmm. That's also another sign, is when people begin to obsess over certain things, let's say about their health. Right. That's a big thing right now. Right. So they become very obsessive. They always want to go to the doctor, or mm-hmm. either they're staying so close up in their house to the point where it's just really deteriorating and mm-hmm. it's just causing some type of disturbance.
Yeah.
So I think that the way that we're really able to tell within our personal relationships is just the fact that people just don't want to do anything mm-hmm. anymore. Mm-hmm. Also, if they're turning to different addictions. Mm-hmm. So now they're drinking more, they're smoking more, mm-hmm. they're doing other risky behaviors. That can definitely be a big sign, because, you know, it's okay, depending on who you are, to socially drink or whatever, but if you're drinking so that you can numb the pain, right. or you're drinking so that you can go to sleep every night, or you're smoking so that, you know, the same,
yeah.
then that becomes a problem, and that is definitely one of the biggest signs that maybe they need to get some help.
Yeah. You know, the social media part is a good thing. I respect that opinion. But me personally, I felt I needed to withdraw.
True.
Because it was the same messaging
yes.
over and over again, and it wasn't helping me.
Mm-hmm.
It was
mm-hmm.
putting me in a depressed state, because yeah. it was some images or just the constant talk about COVID-19 and the pandemic mm-hmm. and things like that just didn't put me in a good space. So I found that while we have been sheltering at home, I have not been on social media mm-hmm. as much as I was before, because the messaging seemed
right.
to be the same and it was putting me in that space.
Right.
There's just so much going on, even with just the pandemic. Our political climate is very intense right now.
Mm-hmm.
The elections are coming. It's really a very critical point for us in time, and people have different opinions about, you know, Black Lives Matter, the movement. What is that really about? But I wanted to ask you, Narissa, how has it impacted us mentally? Has the Black Lives Matter movement and the social injustices that have been happening, are we starting to see an incline with our mental health, just being in a very unsafe or unsecure state? How's it been for you? What do you think?
I definitely think it has caused an incline, but for Black people, it's really nothing different, right?
Mm.
We're used to all of these things happening.
Okay.
We're used to police brutality. We're used to, you know, getting the police called on us for no apparent reason. But now it's just becoming more televised.
Mm.
And so that can also cause a lot of mental strain, because not only are we experiencing these things ourselves in our community, but now we're seeing it replayed over and over
yes.
and over again on social media,
yes.
on the news, and just how it has like spotlighted, which is great because it's bringing awareness to our allies and to other cultures, but it's also causing us to, like you said, mentally deteriorate
mm-hmm.
and to the point where I do suggest that people don't go on social media as much, because you're constantly seeing, you know, the knee on George Floyd's neck.
Mm-hmm.
And just the despair and replaying that over and over and over in your mind, and knowing what happened to Breonna Taylor
mm-hmm.
and seeing that footage, it's too much for us
yes.
sometimes.
Yes.
And we have to put an end to it at times. It's great to be aware. I like to be aware too, but to watch that video over and over and over and over again, it's just too much for your mental health, and it can cause you to become very depressed and at times suicidal.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just too much.
Mm-hmm.
But the Black Lives Matter movement is amazing, and I think that it needs to continue and not just be a moment in time, but a movement. And we really need to, you know, advocate for change. We don't need to stop now. We need to continue on, but we also need to take care of ourselves in the process.
Yeah. Unfortunately, our numbers continue to grow in the space of incarceration for mm-hmm. Black people, especially our Black males.
Mm-hmm.
Any viewpoint or insight as to how mental health is being handled
mm.
for those that are being incarcerated?
It's not being handled very well, if at all.
Yeah.
There's usually one social worker or therapist,
wow.
or maybe two or three
wow.
for an entire prison. Mm-hmm. How am I supposed to get the help that I need when I'm not seeing a therapist or I'm not seeing the psychiatrist at all? And unfortunately, we are seeing where now that, you know, the psychiatric hospitals, a lot of them have closed, especially I know in Michigan where I'm from, that was a big push. Mm-hmm. But now the prisons are expanding, so we're throwing those people that are suffering from mental illnesses into prison. And that is not a rehabilitation center. I don't care what anyone says. Yeah. Prison doesn't do anything but, in some people's opinion, make you a better criminal. Mm. And so, especially for my Black men, I just stand up for them because they need to get help too.
Yes.
And they're not getting that help while they're incarcerated. Right. They're being tortured, they're being enslaved in some ways, you know, the new Jim Crow. It's just, it's really sickening to really think about the things that happen while you're in prison.
Yes.
You're being traumatized over and over and over again every single day, and you're not getting any type of help.
Yeah, and it's such an adjustment
when
they come back out into society, because they have to deal with that and then finding their place in the real world. So it's just a challenge all the way around.
Mm-hmm.
Are there any programs, Narissa, that you can suggest or recommend? So if I'm a person and I feel that I need someone to talk to, what is the first step I should do or take? How can I get a program in my midst or get some help?
So I would say in today's age, the internet is your biggest resource.
Mm-hmm.
It takes nothing but to Google mental health treatment. And actually, I always refer people to psychologytoday.com. You can find a therapist in your area that takes your insurance. And if you don't have insurance, please don't let that stop you. There are community mental health in every single county that should be helping you. And also, just based upon personal experience going through college, you can actually look up any of your major universities that have like a counseling program or a social work program, and they offer free counseling too.
Really?
And so we need to take advantage of those things. And then also, of course, there are many therapists, including myself through my Black Girls Crowned organization, that will offer free therapy to those who need it.
Nice.
And so there, especially now through COVID, a lot of therapists are really seeing the fact that, okay, people need help and some people can't afford it because a lot of people lost their jobs.
Right.
So there are so many different programs, especially like in particular states, that you can literally look up just by Googling it in order to get, you know, free sessions.
That's awesome. A lot of people, a lot of times we don't know where to go to get the help. And we think it's always insurance driven order to have the conversation. Mm-hmm. Go see your primary or internal medicine doctor and they make a recommendation for you to go see someone for counseling. So it's good to know that we can go out here to the internet and just kind of just Google and find free services offered to us. That's so incredible.
Yes.
And that's so helpful.
Yes.
So I wanted to talk to you about some upcoming programs. You talked about your podcast that's coming up soon. I'm excited. Tell us a little bit more about that.
So The Melanated View with Narissa, which will be on Tuesdays at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. We're going to be talking about basically the same things me and Michelle were talking about today, bringing awareness to the Black community in regards to everything that we're dealing with, whether it be politics, whether it be learning how to start a business, getting therapy, just anything that you can name, we're going to be talking about and bringing on guests that have personal experience and professional experience in those areas. So I'm really excited about it, and I hope everyone tunes in because it's definitely needed, especially in today's day and age. Yeah. We need to get real about what's going on, and we really need to talk about it.
Yeah, we do. This month is National Domestic Violence Awareness Month, and unfortunately, due to the pandemic, we're just seeing an increase in numbers with domestic violence. So I know that's a topic that you guys will talk about, because when people survive from that, they do need some type of mental awareness or some health, and so good, congratulations on that.
Thank you.
How can people find you, Narissa? How can people find you? If they wanted to reach out to you or just follow you and support your nonprofit, how can they find you? Where are you?
The number one way is, of course, online. You can go to blackgirlscrowned.com. I am also on social media, on Facebook and Instagram. It's BLK Girls Crowned. And then also The Melanated View, which you can search just right on Facebook.
Awesome. Thank you so much for your time
today. Thank you so much for
having me. This was awesome. Thank you all for joining us. That's my time. Until next time, you guys continue to take care and rock on.